ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರುಭ್ಯೋ ನಮಃ. ಅಸ್ಪೃಷ್ಟದೋಷಗಂಧಾಯ ಕಲ್ಯಾಣಗುಣಸಿಂಧವೇ ನಮೋ ನಮೋ ಭಕ್ತಮುಕ್ತಿದಾಯಿನೇ ಶೇಷಶಾಯಿನೇ. ಶಮಯನ್ ಭವಸಂತಾಪಂ ರಮಯನ್ ಸಾಧುಚಾತಕಾನ್ ಕೃಷ್ಣಮೇಘಃ ಕೃಪಾದೃಷ್ಟಿವೃಷ್ಟ್ಯಾ ಪುಷ್ಣಾತು ಮಾಮಪಿ. ಶ್ರೀಮದಾನಂದತೀರ್ಥಾರ್ಯ ಪಾದಪಂಕಜರೇಣವಃ ಪವಿತ್ರಯಂತು ಮಾಂ ನಿತ್ಯಂ ಪಾಪಪಾಟನ ಪಂಡಿತಾಃ. ತಪಸ್ವಾಧ್ಯಾಯ ಶುಶ್ರೂಷಾ ಕೃಷ್ಣಪೂಜಾರತಂ ಮುನಿಂ ವಿಶ್ವೇಶಂ ಇಷ್ಟದಂ ವಂದೇ ಪರಿವ್ರಾಟ್ ಚಕ್ರವರ್ತಿನಂ. ಇನ್ ದಿ ಪ್ರೀವಿಯಸ್ ವೀಡಿಯೋಸ್ ವಿ ಟಾಕ್ಡ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದಿ ಏಕವಾಕ್ಯತ ಆರ್ ದಿ ಒನ್ ವಾಯ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ವೇದಾಸ್ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ಡಿರೈವ್ಡ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದಿ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಸೂತ್ರಾಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ಎಲ್ಯಾಬರೇಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಶ್ರೀ ಮಧ್ವಾಚಾರ್ಯ. ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ವೀಡಿಯೋ ಐ ವುಡ್ ಅಟೆಂಪ್ಟ್ ಟು ಡೆಮಾನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೇಟ್ ಒನ್ ಸಚ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ವೇ ಆಫ್ doing the samanvaya or actually showing that how are the Vedic texts, right, talk in one voice. So specifically I'll take two problems. So one peculiar way or uniqueness to Sri Madhvacharya's way of Brahmasutra Bhashyas is, it is said in tradition that there were about 21 commentaries to the Brahmasutras before Madhvacharya actually wrote his commentary. If you look at all the 21 commentaries, or at least the major ones, what one can see is that for every sutra or every aphorism of in the Brahma Sutra, there will be what is known as a Vishaya Vakya, right? Or which is the Vedic text that is being analyzed here. So we just talked about applying the entire the Prathama Adhyaya or the first chapter of Brahma Sutra, applying the rules of Upakrama or the natural language processing rules, and trying to derive the one-voicedness of Vedas. Now for that I also mentioned that these sutras are only examples, right? They take one example Vishayavakya or example sentence from the Vedic text and shows how to apply that particular Tatparya Linga or Upakramadi Tatparya Linga in deciding that text. Now that is only shown as an example, but what is intended is that you can use the same Nyaya or the same idea or the same algorithm and apply it to a lot of Vedic texts, because as we mentioned that the Vedas are infinite in number is the tradition. So now how can one sutra explain so many things? You know, there is one algorithm or one idea that is being conveyed in a single sutra. Now everybody, every commentator takes the same Vishayavakya which is being taken by all these commentators for a particular sutra by and large. You know, this is the by and large rule. So now the Vishayavakya that the Shankaracharya takes is the Vishayavakya, the same Vishayavakya that the Ramanujacharya takes. Of course there are differences in the way that they use the sutra and give their commentaries. Nevertheless, the Vishayavakya or the example sentence, right, the Vedic text that is being discussed in a particular sutra remains the same across multiple commentators. But what is extraordinary about Sri Madhvacharya is that 70-80% of the times he takes a different Vishayavakya. See, now this is one of the points of accusation on Sri Madhvacharya, that he deviated from the tradition, right? That he takes different Vishayavakyas. But if one carefully looks at the sutra text, right, one can see that the Vishayavakyas or the example text that the Madhvacharya has taken adheres much better to the aphorisms or the sutras, the Brahma Sutras, than the other commentaries. Of course, this is my personal opinion. Now, why am I saying all this is, I will show you a very, you know, very big, convincing, glaring example of this thing. Now, in the fourth pada, right, I mean, so Brahma Sutra goes like this. There are four different chapters which are called the Adhyayas. Every Adhyaya has sub-chapters which are called the Padas. Okay. So now the first Adhyaya, as I mentioned in the previous video, is dedicated to using these tatparalingas and talking about the samanvaya or the one voicedness of all the Vedas that has been said in the Tattu Samanvaya Sutra. Right? So that is why it is called the Samanvaya Adhyaya, the very first Adhyaya. The fourth subchapter of the first Samanvaya Adhyaya, right, is the fourth Pada. So, you know, all the commentators, most of the commentators for the Brahma Sutra have said that this fourth Pada, the entire fourth Pada, is dedicated to what is known as the refutation of the Sankhya school of philosophy. Right? So now, what is the Sankhya school of philosophy? Sankhya Darshana is one of the six darshanas, the Shat Darshanas that were there in the Indian tradition. So they say that the Prakriti or the nature is the major cause of the universe. Okay. So now they say the Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya, and Yadav Prakasha, most of the previous commentators say that the entire fourth Pada of the first Adhyaya is dedicated to refute the ideas of Sankhyas. Now Madhvacharya asks a question here. He says that how is it relevant to the Samanvaya Adhyaya? The second Adhyaya of the Brahma Sutra is called as the Avirodha Adhyaya, where everybody has a consensus, all commentators has a consensus, that this second Adhyaya is dedicated to refute the other ideas or the other darshanas. Okay? All the Bauddha, all non-Vaidic darshanas have been summarized there and have been refuted. Now the question is, how does the refutation of Sankhya idea fall in the ambit of the Samanvaya Adhyaya? So this is the question that the Madhvacharya asks, and he says that you are mistaken. This fourth Pada of first Adhyaya, the Samanvaya Adhyaya, is not dedicated to the refutation of Sankhyas, but it is dedicated to a much, much bigger cause of showing the one-voicedness of the Vedas in the most difficult parts of the Vedic texts. Okay? So now what are those most difficult parts? He says in the Anavyakhyana that Virodhi Sarva Vedanta Karanastri Nishedhinam Samanvayotra Kathitaha. So this is what is done in the fourth Pada. He says that, okay, you can, here is the summary. So what is said is, we talked about the presence of an Agni Sukta, right? Agni Mile Purohitam is Agni Sukta. And they show that, okay, the Agni that has been said, that is not the popular Agni, but it is the Brahman, because there is a linga, or there is an attribute that is there for the Agni, which is said in that Sukta, which is like antaryamitva, I mean being inside everybody and being inside everybody and being responsible for their acts. So this is only a specific Brahma's attribute. That is why the Agni there is Brahma. Okay, so okay, this is okay. We can agree. There are a lot of texts, Vedic texts, which has words like dukhi. Right? Adukha mitarat sarvam jiva eva tu dukhinaha. So this is a Vedic text. So now there is a word called dukhi. Now, how does this word dukhi is referring to Brahman? You cannot say, see, the word dukhi means someone who has dukkha, right? So now how is this word referring to Brahman? When Brahma cannot have dukkha, right? Now, and there are lot of texts, as I mentioned, the Brahmana texts that talks about the rituals. For example, Vasante Vasante Jyotisha Ejeta is a Brahmana text. Ahar Sandhyam Upasita. So this says that a Brahmin has to perform Sandhya Vandana morning and evening. Now, Vasante Vasante Jyotisha Ejeta. Right? So, in every the Vasanta time or the autumn time, right? The Brahmin has to perform a yaga called the Jyotishthoma. That's what this text means. So, now, how is this talking about Brahman? Right? So, there is another word called Baddha in Veda. Right? So Baddha means somebody who is tied. That is the quality of Jiva. How is this word Baddha is conveying Brahman? So now your claim is Samanvaya, right? Tattu Samanvaya. Every word, every text, every sentence in the Veda is talking about the quality of Brahman is what you have claimed. But here is a contradiction to your claim in the Vedic text that talks of the Dukhi word. There is a Baddha word. And there are all these texts that talk of the karma or the rituals that apparently doesn't seem to be doing anything with the qualities of Brahman? Such a big question to be answered. So now, Madhvacharya said, here are the texts that are being discussed in the first adhyaya, fourth pada. It is not there for the refutation of Sankhyas. One, see, I keep saying this to people that if you apparently look at the philosophical tenets of Sri Madhvacharya, they doesn't seem to be like novel. For example, the idea of Vishnu being the supreme Godhead or the Sarvottama is an idea that was there. For example, the Ramanadacharya also had the same idea. The idea of differences or the Bheda, right, is also not an alien idea, because all the Nayayikas talked about Bheda, right? And the idea of the Satyatva of the world or the absolute truth value of the world is also not a novel idea. So now perhaps this is one of the reasons why the so-called Indian Indologists of Western world do not count Madhva's philosophy as a philosophy that is to be. In fact, I have read myself that there was one philosopher called Professor Hiriyanna in Mysore University who has written a book called Summary of Indian Philosophy, something of that sort. I don't remember the name exactly. So there he counts all philosophies except for Madhvacharya's philosophy, and this is a story that I have heard, that when somebody asked him, you know, why is it being left out, he says that this is nothing novel in Madhvacharya's philosophy to be counted as a philosophy. Now, apparently it seems true, because all these ideas were anyway there, but to comprehend the novelty of Sri Madhvacharya's work, one has to deeply look at these philosophical questions that were bothering a lot of philosophers. The Vedic philosophers, which were left completely unanswered, but Sri Madhvacharya took it up and answered in a very, very convincing way. I mean, this is one of the many questions that philosophers asked, but nobody has answered, but Madhvacharya has answered, right? I mean, at a very, very surfacial level, it is true that Vishnu Sarvottamatva and these ideas were there, and nobody took these very strong philosophical questions and answered the way Sri Madhvacharya did. Anyway, coming back, so the question that we are trying to answer right now is, How do you show that a word like Dukhi or the word like Baddha or all these sentences that talk of Vasante, Vasante, Jyotishaya Jeta are talking about the attributes of Brahman, right? So he took some of these sutras, Anumanikam Ekesha Mati Chenna, Sharir Rupaka Vinyasta Grihiter Darshayati is the first sutra of the fourth pada. Sukshmantu tatarhatvat, tadadhinatvat arthavat, kalponopadeshacha madhvadivad avirodaha, samakrashat, vakyanvayat, jagadvachitvat. These are the wonderful set of sutras, right, that precisely deal with this question, I mean, and tries to answer this. I mean, look at the way the Madhvacharya answers this question. So let us take this one example of Dukhi. Now, this word, this word Dukhi, if you look at the etymology of this word, etymology is the science of dividing the, if you are given a word, you go to the root of the word, break it, and then ascribe a meaning to the word. You know, Dukhi, if you look at the word Dukhi, here is the etymology in Sanskrit, Dukkha asya asti iti Dukhi is the etymology. So there is a pratyaya called Matup, right, that comes from the word Dukkha and gives rise to this word called Dukhi. So it means somebody who has Dukkha. Now the question is, how do you say that the word Dukhi is referring to Brahman, because he does not have Dukkha? Now here is the answer. The Shruti says, the Sutra says, tadadhinatvat arthavat. Now Madhvacharya takes this very interesting example that, okay, this pratyaya matup has come here, agreed. But the matup has multiple ideas, I mean, has multiple meanings, as indicated in the sutra itself. He shows another word, right, where the matup has come, but it does not convey the same meaning as the word Dukhi is conveying. Here is the example. He says, there is a king, right, who is sitting in his air-conditioned room, right, and there is a war that is going on. Okay, the king never goes to the battlefield. his army goes and the army wins the battle. What do people say? People say that the king won the battle. Right? Kuto ragni jayo anyatha. This is what the sentence is in the Anuvyakhyana. Kuto ragni jayo anyatha. So people say Raja jayi. Right? So the king or the Raja never went to the battlefield. So how is Raja then said jayi? So now here is the philosophical idea behind it. The pratyaya matup conveys two meanings. The first meaning is the possession, the physical possession of it. Example is dukhi, right? The word dukhi means somebody who has dukkha, right? Matub also means, in the case of Raja Jayi, that somebody who controls the Jaya, right? So why is the king said Jayi? Another example is dhani. Right? Dhani means somebody. I mean, these kinds of words exist in other languages too. For example, in English, there's a word called somebody who is wealthy. Right? It doesn't mean that the man holds all the wealth on his head. Right? It only means that he controls wealth. Right? Dhani means somebody who controls the dhana. Jayi means somebody who controls the jaya. Dukhi means somebody who controls the dukkha, right? So this is a very beautiful idea which the Madhvacharya has said, which is derived from the sutra called Tad Adhinatvat Arthavat. So he says, Svatantriyam Tadgatatvancha Shabda Vrittehi Karanam Svatantriyam Tatra Mukhyam Syat Kuto Ragni Jayonyatha. So he says that there are two controlling factors, right? Two governing factors, rather, which control when the matup pratyaya comes. See, one is of course the possession in the case of dukhi, and when the jiva is referred to as dukhi, or people like us are referred to as dukhi, we actually possess dukkha. The second governing factor of the matup is what is known as the swatantriya, or the controlling. The fact that the king controls the entire army, the jaya or the act of winning is controlled completely by the king. That is why the word jayi now gets ascribed to the king. So svatantriyam tadgatatvancha shabdavrittehi karanam. He goes one step further and he says that it is not only that these two are the governing factors of being called using matup. It is also the fact that swatantriya, or the fact that whatever is being controlled, is more important than possession. Right? Why is that? So if you are possessing it, for example, if a soul or a jiva is called dukkhi, he cannot do anything about the dukkha. So we all do not want dukkha. I mean, we just possess dukkha, and that is why we are called dukkhi. But when matup is used, or this pratyaya is used, and Raja is called jayi, he literally controls the jaya. So the fact that something is being controlled, for dhani for example, because he controls the entire wealth, he is called a wealthy person. Right? So svatantriyam tatra mukhyam syat. The more important governing factor is the svatantriya. And that is why when you say dukhi, more importantly, it refers to Brahman, and less importantly, it refers to the jiva. Because dukkhi, the word by itself means that somebody who controls dukkha, which is the Brahman. It also means, by a lesser important governing factor or the vritti, it also means that somebody who possesses dukkha, which is the jiva. Now, this way, any words, every word in the Veda, which apparently seems to be not conveying any quality of Brahman, also can be shown to be conveying Brahman. So the fact that he controls every dukkha, bhayakrit bhayanashanaha, right? I mean, the fact that he controls all the bhaya, all the dukkha, all the negative qualities of everything, everybody and everything, he can be called by those negative words. So this is a very beautiful idea that is being said in Brahma Sutra, in the Anumanika Adhikarana, or the Tadadhinatvat Arthavat Brahma Sutra. Different commentators have given different meanings, but I personally feel that this meaning is such a beautiful meaning that Sri Madhvacharya has given. So now the second question, I will end by answering the second question that we just take. What about the Vasante Vasante Jyotisha Ejeta? Right? So Madhvacharya actually asks a very interesting question on top of it. Now if you say that it only talks about karma, right? Now why are these, I mean, who are these karmic vakyas dedicated to? These are dedicated to people like us. Ahara Sandhya Upasita, the Vedas are actually telling us that you have to do Sandhya Vandana. Now, what happens when we are not there? In tradition, it is believed that in the time of Pralaya or the end of everything, no Jiva will be there in the Srishti and only the Brahman or the Paramatma will exist. So now, what happens during that time? So when if the Veda says Vasante Vasante Jyotishaya Deta, so what is it saying? Either it should be meaningless, right? Or it should say something else. So this is a question that he says, and see, the another greatness of Sri Madhvacharya is that he does not just make claims. He backs all of his claims by other Vedic or the Puranic texts. Every single of Sri Madhvacharya's claims in the Brahma Sutra Bhashya has been backed up by a citation. So this is one practice that we routinely follow in writing scientific articles today, right? I myself being practicing that art. So my doctoral advisor used to tell me always that if you write a sentence, either back it up through experimentation or through a citation. Citation means previously established work that is already being published somewhere. Okay, so now that's exactly the way that Madhvacharya takes in his entire Brahma Sutra Bhashya, where every of his claim, every single of, not only in Brahma Sutra Bhashya, all his works. That is why he stands as such a different philosopher, where every of his single claim is backed up by a citation or a logic. Right, so coming back, so what happens to Vasante Vasante Jyotisha Ejeta, right? So he asked this question. So something has to be done about this during the Pralaya time, right? And there are lots of Vedic texts where he says Mam Vidhatte Avidhatte Mam. Okay, so where the Brahman claims that during the Pralaya it only talks about me. So now how do you reconcile this fact? So there is this Brahma Sutra again which says Jyotirupakramat Kalpanopadesha cha Madhadivat Avirodha. So where, so Madhvacharya, one other peculiar idea of Sri Madhvacharya is to go to the etymological root of the word, right? So let's look at this word, right? Jyotish, Jyotisha is the word. So now he breaks the word as Jyotihi, Jyotisha, Ayajeta. The word actually is, I mean, in the well-known meaning, it is Jyotisha Yajeta. He breaks that as Jyotisha Ayajeta, right? And even the word Jyoti is broken as G and Oti. Okay? So now he says Brahman is called G because of this reason. Brahman is called Oti because Otatvat Oti Ruchyate. So because he is Vyapta everywhere, he is called Oti. He is called G because of this reason. He is called Ayajeta because of this reason. So he breaks down every word into its roots and etymological roots and says that every of this word is nothing but a Sambodhana of Brahman. What is Sambodhana? Look at a stotra. I mean, if you chant Vishnu Sahasranama or something, there is no Kriya, there is no verb there, right? Vishwam, Vishnu, Vashatkaraha. Just the names of the Brahman, right? Just like that, the entire Veda is nothing but the names of Brahman, all Sambuddhis. Right? I mean, Ji means Brahman, Oti means Brahman, Ayajeta means Brahman, Vasanta means Brahman. He shows, not only that he climbs, but in his Anuvyakhyana, he actually goes to the roots, the Vyakarana, using the famous Paninian Vyakarana grammar, and shows that every of this single word, how can this be actually attributed to the Brahman? So now the question is that, and you are making bizarre and awkward claims, and nobody even claimed these kinds of things. But Madhvacharya actually shows that these ideas are there in these Kalpanopadeshad Madhvadivata Virodaha Sutra. He actually backs all of his claims from this Upanishad Vakya that says that tam yet chatam varshani abhirchata tasma chatarchinas tasma chatarchinaha tasma chatarchinaha ityachakshate etameva santam. This Upanishad, this text actually says, so what it means is the following. It says that there is a word called Shatarchi, right? The usual meaning is that it's a collection of 100 rishis, okay? So now this particular Veda says that also is a meaning, but Brahman is called Shatarchi because Shatam Varshani Abhyarchata. So all rishis are human beings, worship him for 100 years, and that is why he is called Shatarchi. So now Upanishad itself shows that a given word can be broken into many many etymological ways and can be shown different meanings. And that is what the Sutrakara is also saying in Jyotirupakramat Sutra. So Madhvacharya uses all these rules and shows that the entire gamut, when we discuss two ideas here, one is the Tadadhinatva idea, where he shows that the ownership or the Svatantriya is also a governing factor for having the matup pratyaya in the case of dukhi, etc. words. And the second idea, which is going to the etymological roots and breaking it into different etymological derivations and saying that the entire Vedic texts are nothing but the sambuddhis, are saying different qualities of Brahman as derived from the Tadadhinatva Sutra and the Jyotirupakrama Sutra, are the extraordinary jewels of the Brahma Sutra Bhashya of Sri Madhvacharya, which is very unique and extremely novel as far as the Vedic culture is concerned. No sutrakara, no commentator or the Bhashyakara for the Brahma Sutra has actually derived these ideas from the sutras. In fact, he backs it up from lot of different smriti and purana text, the claims of his. When everybody does Vedadhyana, right? Every adhyapaka or every Vedic teacher traditionally says this shloka at the end. Vedakshanani yavanti patitani dvijatibihi tavanti harinamani kirtitani nasamshayaha. So it literally means that as many Vedic words have been chanted, so many harinamas have been chanted. Vedakshanani yavanti patitani tavanti harinamani kirtitani. So he says that, you see all these vakya, why did this vakya come up? And tava eta sarve ruchaha sarve vedaha sarve ghoshaha ekeva vyakritihi prane. So Vedas themselves are, Upanishads are themselves saying that the entire Vedas, entire texts are referring to one Brahman. See, now if you are saying entire text, why do you leave a single vakya? So Madhvacharya says that, don't say that only a few important vakyas are the ones, or the texts that are to be seen, and the rest are to be ignored. Saying, why do you leave? I mean, Brahma Sutra, the very heart of Brahma Sutra is to come up with different ideas that would show how Vedic texts are referring to the Brahman. And here are the two very important ideas that he presents, taking Sutra as the background. And this is where I personally feel that the Madhvacharya is extremely novel philosopher as far as the Indian philosophical school is concerned. Okay, thank you. Krishna.